Hello, everybody here and out there in interwebs land. Glad you're here, either now or at some unspecified time in the future when you're listening to this webinar. I'm Dr. Kate Hurley. A lot of you met me earlier in the day in physical reality, but I'm the director of the Correct Shelter Medicine Program at UC Davis. And I say this about a lot of topics, but this is my favorite topic, along with others. And it's just thinking about it today, in fact, and thinking about how not only is feline upper respiratory infection an important story in itself, it's a disease that affects a lot of shelter cats and causes a lot of havoc and suffering and even, in many cases, death for cats in shelters. So it's important to understand how to manage it, but I think it's also a great story about where sheltering and where shelter medicine has come since I was dog catcher at Santa Cruz SPCA 20 plus years ago. And that's a picture of me mishandling a cat. And this is a headline from the AVMA from last month. Plan for the shelter medicine specialty open for comments. So we're in our last year, hopefully, of our preparation for a board specialty in shelter medicine. That's very exciting. And when that picture was taken, I remember, you know, if a cat sneezed, we had no concept of any way we could manage that cat at the shelter. There was no thought that there would be a way we could keep the cat at the shelter and treat it and prevent spread of infection to the other cats. So if a cat sneezed, it was my job or the job of anyone on the staff to march into the kennel manager's office, report it, get the cat, take it back to the euthanasia room, and euthanize it. And I remember a time when I had brought back a litter of foster kittens. There was a small, medium, and large orange cat. They were just called small, medium, and large orange. And Callie the calico. And Callie got adopted, and medium orange got adopted. And about a week after I brought them back to the shelter, I walked into the euthanasia room, and there was the other two orange kittens getting euthanized. And the rule was you couldn't question a euthanasia decision. I understood at that time that that was our idea of how we could best keep our cats in general healthy. I understood at that time that we had more cats for adoption than we could ever adopt out. So if not them, then someone else. But I still walked out of that euthanasia room thinking, God, you know, there must be some better way. And I went to vet school and I learned, you know, so much that you're learning now. And I saw the amazing things that we could do for animals and that we had MRI and CT scans and we could put new kidneys in cats. And I thought about my small and large orange foster kittens that died because they caught a kitty cold. And I thought, you know, there has just got to be some better way of responding to that. And I'm gonna go and I'm gonna be a shelter vet. And I'm gonna treat those kitties. And I'm gonna save them. And it'll be great. And then I went, I got a job at the Dane County Humane Society as a new idealistic shelter vet. And I remember a day that I was standing outside the isolation room and the isolation room was full and there was cats in cages stacked in the hallway, three high with towels over them with upper respiratory infection. And it was my choice to decide, was I gonna euthanize some of the cats I had already started treatment on, or was I gonna euthanize some of the cats that had just gotten sick? And I thought, God, there has got to be a better way of handling this. So I heard that there was a residency in shelter medicine starting up at UC Davis. So I signed up and I was like, yes, I would like to earn less than I did as a dog catcher and learn all about this. And, you know, so I went and had 3 years to do nothing but read the literature, read research, talk to people, study how to do things better in shelters. And still, I would get calls from veterinarians working in shelters saying, you know, I've tried everything, and, you know, we've changed our vaccine, we've changed our disinfectant, we've changed our housing, and we're still seeing upper respiratory infection, and he still thought that there had to be some better way. And I've been giving this talk ever since my first year as a resident, and every year there's been another study and another piece of the puzzle, until finally, within the last year or so, I feel like we understand feline upper respiratory infection. We understand it at an individual cat level, we understand it at a shelter population level, and we understand it at a community level, and we have answers, and that's really amazing to see as part of the maturing of a new science within veterinary medicine. So I hope that that will inspire you, not just about feline URI, but about how to solve a big complex problem. So this is one of the things that drives me. It's not just a kitty cold, right? URI hurts. Hurts to be a cat that's in a shelter and your life already kind of sucks. And then on top of that, you have ulcers on your tongue and your eyes hurt and you don't want to eat. And you're there, like your whole job is to be so attractive that somebody falls in love with you and takes you home forever. But you look like this and you feel like this. And, you know, how do we solve this problem? Well, this was an interesting study. I actually saw this data years before it was published, because that's how it is sometimes. This is the risk of upper respiratory infection in a pretty typical U.S. shelter. Not a terrible shelter, not like amazing innovative housing, but housing that looks a lot like what you'll see in shelters throughout the U.S., throughout North America generally. And this is the risk of URI over time. And you can see here it is. By the time a cat has been in the shelter for 2 weeks, risk of disease was over 80%. Now, certainly the experience that I had as an animal care attendant at an animal shelter, if a cat stayed long enough, we just think, gonna hear her start to sneeze any day now. And at that shelter, out of about 2,200 cats, over 660 got up a respiratory infection while they were in the shelter, and many of the cats just didn't stay long enough maybe to develop signs of upper respiratory infection. Either they were euthanized or they were adopted before they had a chance to break with signs of illness. Right around that same time, another study came out that described risk of upper respiratory infection in shelters in the UK, where they have really different ways of handling and housing cats, and really different ways of responding to cats in communities. And this also shows the risk of upper respiratory infection over time, but what you see is sort of the opposite pattern, where it goes down in a stepwise manner, so that the cats became less likely to get sick over time. And how amazing is that? That a shelter was a place where cats were safer day by day in the shelter's care. And overall, of over 1,400 cats, only 60 got upper respiratory infection. So almost a tenfold difference. Interesting, huh? What is that about? Well, we looked into it a little bit further, and this was a pilot study that Dane County Humane Society participated in. And we tracked the risk per cat per day in several shelters and over a period of a year. And you can see it went up and down within each shelter, but these three different shelters hardly ever even crossed their minds. So there was a shelter that was pretty high risk, medium risk, and then very low risk. Yeah?
When you're saying risk, what criteria did you use to evaluate risk?
So when I say risk, we wanted to adjust it not only for the number of cats, but the number of days each cat was available to get up a respiratory infection. So obviously if a shelter takes in 100 cats and they each stay 3 days, that's different than if they take in 100 cats and they each stay 30 days, right? So it was the number of cases of upper respiratory infection expressed per cat day or per 1,000 cat days. And any cat, a cat day at risk was a day that a cat was in the shelter and didn't already have URI. So it was a likelihood that on a given day, a cat would get upper respiratory infection. And as a percentage of intake, the frequency was between about 4% and 25%. So even as just like how many, you know, of cats that came in, how many got sick, a fivefold difference there. Why? Why so different? It wasn't obvious from just looking at the shelters. So this is my old, this is from a presentation that I used to give of what causes feline upper respiratory infection. If you read the literature, this is what you'll learn. And this is probably true when you're dealing with pet cats, not coming to you from a shelter context. That most respiratory disease in cats is caused by viruses, and that in pet cats, probably herpes and calicy, this is the common wisdom, are about equal contributors. And then bacterial players are less important, but can be a component of feline upper respiratory disease complex, so Chlamydophila felis, Bordetella, and Mycoplasma. One of the things we wondered was, do cats just coming into shelters carry those viruses and bacteria at different rates? Are some shelters just taking in cats that are healthier than others to start with? Well, no. We found out shelters with lower or higher respiratory disease rates, if you just sample the cats on intake, we find exactly the same percentage of cats already infected with those different viruses and bacteria. But once they got sick, we saw a very different pattern emerge. At most of the shelters we studied, here's Chlamydophila felis. Rare. We don't see it much. We see it slightly more frequently in cats with upper respiratory infection than in cats without. Calicivirus, virus, almost the same. There was no significant difference in the frequency of calicivirus virus in cats that were perfectly healthy and in cats that had upper respiratory infection. This one is Bordetella, and it was more frequent in cats with upper respiratory infection, but once we took out one shelter for 2/4 that had a Bordetella outbreak, there was no significant difference in the rest of the shelters that we studied for the rest of the time of the study. And Mycoplasma felis was common both in cats with and without upper respiratory infection, no significant difference. What does that leave? That leaves herpes virus as the number 1, 2, 3, 4, and 5 cause of upper respiratory infection in shelter cats. Except at that one shelter that was the blue line that just ran across the bottom of the graph, there, herpes virus was no more frequent, in fact, it was a little less common in cats with upper respiratory infection than in cats newly admitted to the shelter. There was no significant difference. There was a difference between chlamydia, calicivirus virus, Bordetella, and Mycoplasma. So once we took out herpes virus as an element of it, of upper respiratory infection, then we saw the other players come forward as contributors to disease. So that may be more like what you see in a pet cat that's from a non-shelter type environment. But when you're looking at a shelter cat from a typical shelter where there's endemic upper respiratory infection, herpes virus is going to be the most significant contributor. Why do you think that is? Stress associated. So of these 5 pathogens, herpes is the only one that's directly linked to stress. So stress in general makes animals more vulnerable to illness, but herpes is turned on by stress. And the trouble with herpes is that it's also turned on by pregnancy and birthing. So many cats are infected very early in life before they have a chance to turn around and even think about it. And so you saw, this is the distribution of pathogens in perfectly healthy cats on intake. They walk in the door already infected with herpes virus on a regular basis, already even shedding it in some cases. And so there's the opportunity to reactivate that in cats that walk in the door, even if you kept them utterly isolated from any other cat. You could turn on the herpes and virus infection that they came pre-equipped with when they're in the shelter. And one thing that we've known, in fact, since the 70s, is that just moving a cat from one cage to another, or moving a cat from a cage to a carrier and back, is enough to trigger herpes virus infection in 20 to 80% of cats. And so when we have a housing environment where just to clean a cat from day to day, you have to move it from one cage to another or put it in a carrier and put it somewhere else, We have a setup that's just going to trigger herpes virus infection very efficiently. Introduction of new cats, and especially intact new cats, into a group. So in a group housing environment, introduction of new cats can be a very stressful event. In one study, it was enough to trigger herpes virus, even in cats that had been negative after two high immunosuppressive doses of corticosteroids. So mixing new cats together was more stressful than the stress, or the chemically created stress, of a steroid injection. And so here's a mother and kittens. They're already at risk, right? Because pregnancy, birthing, nursing, and she's in a carrier on the bottom shelf. She was in an intake room. Dogs were walking by. And so what happened to her in just those first minutes of her shelter experience might undo any other effort that you might engage in, any vaccines you might give, any nutritional support you might provide, any careful disinfection you might do from day to day, might already be defeated by this early experience. So here's a question for you. This is one of the classic signs of herpes virus infection, is it attacks the eye. And in really severe cases, it can cause corneal ulceration and even rupture. When this cat is recovered from her herpes virus infection, may we treat the eyes, can she just go up for adoption? Can she go to a home with other cats, or do we gotta be extra careful with her? How many people say, you know what, I would just put her up for adoption. Poor thing, she's been through enough. How many people say, my God, I don't want that to happen to another cat. She needs to go to a one cat home. Okay, and we have a lot of undecideds. Remember, a lot of cats just walk in the door of shelter carrying herpes virus. They get it at birth. So it's not exciting that a cat has herpes virus. And herpes is not a strainy virus. So there's not like a strain of herpes that causes corneal ulceration. There's not a lot of variability within herpes. It's a DNA virus, and so some of you might know that DNA viruses, you know, DNA is already the genetic material, and so they tend to replicate more consistently. And so to the extent that vaccines protect against herpes, they protect against all herpes. They don't do a great job, but they do a consistent job. We don't recognize vaccine-resistant strains of herpes. And we also don't recognize ulcery strains of herpes. So the fact that this cat experienced corneal ulceration has more to do with the dose she was exposed to, the route of exposure, and her own immune system than the fact that she, maybe she even already came into the shelter carrying herpes virus. So she can go off for adoption, no limitations. So that's cool to know. Because when you're dealing with cats that have recovered from upper respiratory infection or are being treated for upper respiratory infection in a URI endemic environment, in a URI endemic shelter, unless there's something extraordinary going on, you can kind of assume it's all herpes. And they can be exposed to each other. You don't have to freak out about treating them and not letting them out of the cages and not giving them any social time. You don't have to freak out about, like, once they recover, they're a threat to other cats forevermore. Like, they can just go back up for adoption. And remember, all the cats that come in, some of them are already shedding herpes virus. So as soon as they're clinically recovered from signs, they're not shedding an unusual amount. It's not just that you let disease control fly out the window, but you don't have to be especially concerned about it. Yeah. So the question is, would you specifically inform the owner that this cat has herpes? And I would not, because many cats that come from shelters, that come from catteries, that come from any multi-cat background are going to have herpes, are going to have Khaleesi virus. It's not unusual, and it's not a particular risk, and it's just going to burden the cat, the idea of like, oh my God, I better not kiss the cat. Yeah. So the question is, do you follow the same rule of thumb when you have mouth ulcers? Nicely done. Pay you later. How many people think, yes, Khaleesi, mouth ulcers. Go ahead, put it up for adoption. She's been through enough. How many of you think, yeah, no, there's a little hint. There's a pattern going on. We're good test takers. We're going to be more careful with this one. Khaleesi virus is an RNA virus. And so it has to make DNA. And then it has to make genetic material. And there is more opportunities for mistakes to be made with RNA viruses. They're more mutation prone. A Khaleesi virus is strainy. So a Khaleesi that causes oral ulceration is more likely to cause oral ulceration in another cat. A Khaleesi that causes limping is more likely to cause limping in another cat. A Khaleesi that causes virulent systemic disease is more likely to cause virulent systemic disease. And the cat's immune system has nothing to do with it. So a virulent Khaleesi virus can attack a perfectly healthy cat with a fully functioning, robust immune system. In fact, Khaleesi virus can be more severe in cats with good immune response because the immune response itself can be part of Khaleesi viral disease. So I don't want you to get the impression that oral ulcers equals Khaleesi or that Khaleesi equals oral ulcers. Those of you who were here this afternoon saw that quaternary ammonium toxicity can cause oral ulceration in a group of cats. Herpes can occasionally cause oral ulceration, although since it's not strainy, you wouldn't see a group of cats with oral ulcers from herpes virus. So if you see a group of cats with oral ulcers, probably Khaleesi or quaternary ammonium toxicity. But most Khaleesi doesn't actually cause oral ulcers. So you don't actually know always when you're dealing with Khaleesi virus. And as you saw, cats that come into shelters commonly carry Khaleesi virus. Cats with respiratory infection commonly have Khaleesi virus just as an incidental finding, and it's not the cause of their upper respiratory infection. But if you have a group of cats where some cats are severely affected and either Khaleesi virus is diagnosed or there are clinical signs consistent with Khaleesi virus, there is severe oral ulceration along with other severe disease, then you need to think that any cat that has any level of infection, even very mild infection, can transmit the most severe manifestation of that Khaleesi virus strain to another cat. And some Khaleesi viruses are not only highly virulent, but they're also vaccine resistant. Those things don't have to go together, but they can. And obviously, when those two things partner up, when we have a highly virulent vaccine resistant strain, then that's very dangerous, because that can go and get out into the community and transmit illness at a spay-neuter clinic, or illness when the cat goes in for its post-adoption exam, or illness in a foster home where you end up having to treat, or even where it ends up killing the foster parent's pets. Worst case scenario. So you wanna evaluate Khaleesi virus very carefully. You don't wanna jump to the conclusion that you have Khaleesi virus. You wanna do some diagnostics and make sure that you're obtaining Khaleesi virus at more than the expected background frequency from a group of cats. If you have a cat that dies with possible Khaleesi viral infection, you want to invest in necropsy and histopathology, because it's a big deal to call a virulent Khaleesi virus in a population, because then you have to freak out about all the cats in that population. And you want to think about what's sort of the overall pattern. If there's a lot conspiring against the cats and towards disease in the shelter, you're actually less worried about the risk that that cat poses in a pet home. So if it's filthy and the cats aren't vaccinated and it's very stressful and then they're getting bad upper respiratory infection, then you can think, well, you know, once it goes out into a home and the cat, you know, it's a healthy environment, it's probably not going to be as dangerous. Whereas if the shelter conditions are good and it's still really getting the cats that bad, then you have to worry more about it. And especially if you find that fully healthy adult vaccinated cats are affected, like the shelter cat or the clinic cat is affected, or people's pets in their homes, like technician cats, are affected, then you want to really worry about it. And the reason that's a problem is because cats can shed Khaleesi virus for months after recovery. And at least in the first few weeks after recovery from a virulent Khaleesi virus, they can transmit severe disease. So you either have to do a long quarantine period or like put them all in a garage for a year. It's difficult. Luckily, it's rare. If you ever feel like you're dealing with a virulent Khaleesi virus outbreak, you're welcome to get in touch through sheltermedicine.com and just have us help you verify that that's really what you're dealing with and come up with a plan for exposed cats. Any questions about that? Yeah. So the question, part one of the question is sometimes when a cat has recovered from herpes, does the stress of either moving it up to adoption or the stress of moving it to a new home gonna cause a recrudescence of the infection? And the second part of the question is that a risk then to other pets? And there is a refractory period after cats have recovered from a herpes infection, so you have a few weeks usually where they are not gonna re-break. What can happen is sometimes when sort of the whole system is jammed up and like adoption was full and so the cat sat in isolation for another 10 days while we were waiting for space to open up on the adoption floor, then by that time, it's kind of already starting to incubate something else, or it's like, become vulnerable to herpes virus infection again, and then the stress of the move does reactivate it, and they can kind of bounce back and forth. So I'm gonna talk about that a little bit more in the treatment section. But in general, in terms of, you know, shedding and risk posed by cats to other cats, whenever there is liquid pouring out their eyes and nose and mouth, like they're drooling because they have ulcers and they're sneezing and they're spraying it all over, they're shedding at a much, much higher rate. So even though once they recover, if you stick a swab around in their tonsils, you can still get that virus out, they're a much lower risk once they just stop having fluids dripping out of their body. So in general, you can get away with just not waiting a whole long time after cats have recovered. You don't have to call them like a big risk for another 2 months until you're sure that they've stopped shedding. It's only with super virulent Khaleesi viruses. When you move a cat into a new home, sometimes the stress of that move is gonna be the one that gets the best of them, and they start sneezing when they're in the new home. Commonly, you know, we vaccinate cats for herpes virus and it provides mediocre protection. So it'll be common that a cat will get into a new home and sneeze and it won't go to the new cat. Obviously, you should tell people to keep cats separate, you know, partly just to help the cats have some time to adjust to each other. If you're worried about Khaleesi virus, you want to be more careful about that. But very often, really, if the cat in the home starts sneezing, it's likely as not the cat had its own herpes virus, and having a new roommate triggered its own herpes virus infection that it already had. So remember, we do have some vaccine protection against herpes virus.
Don't you think also, I think you have to think about what's stressful, and certainly moving from one place to another is stressful, but usually moving from a shelter to a home is probably a lot less stressful than staying another day in the shelter.
So just a reminder, this is another study that we did looking at the frequency of pathogens in healthy and cats with upper respiratory infections. This is a big study of about 500 cats. And again, 27% of healthy cats in shelters and 28% of cats with upper respiratory infection in shelters had Khaleesi virus. So every once in a while I hear about situations where cats were euthanized because Khaleesi virus was diagnosed. That is inappropriate. Really have to base it on the science in a group of cats. So it used to be, this is another sort of older slide that, like, you diagnose, you know, you send in a swab and you get back herpes and you're like, eh, what does it mean? You know, a quarter of the cats in a shelter coming from a multi-cat environment are gonna have herpes, so is that the cause of the cat's clinical sign? But now there are PCR panels that test for all the major pathogens associated with feline upper respiratory disease complex, and PCR is very good at finding disease if it's there, as long as the sample was taken correctly. And so if it's negative, you can say, you know what, I swabbed a few cats, none of them have Khaleesi virus, I'm not dealing with Khaleesi virus here. I need to look again at the quaternary ammonium toxicity possibility. So it can be helpful to rule out disease. It can be helpful to get samples if it's, you know, maybe a potential legal case, because we can do DNA tracking and actually see where Khaleesi virus came from. If there's unusually severe or frequent disease in a population as a whole, remember I showed you that graph at the beginning where Bordetella was common in one shelter for a couple of quarters, and they were seeing more severe disease, and it wasn't responding to antibiotic treatment in quite the way that was normal. And if you send in a panel from 10 cats, and 8 of them have Bordetella, or 4 of them have chlamydia, you can look at what's the expected background level. We have enough information for you to be able to tell, well, that's more than I would expect out of a group of 10 cats. So it can be helpful in that regard. And IDEX now offers quantitative PCR results, at least for herpes virus, that can help you distinguish, like, that's probably background infection. This one is probably associated with clinical signs. So a cat has a chronically blinky eye. Every time the owners go out of town, it starts blinking. And you wonder if that might be herpes virus associated, and you can send that into IDEX and get a pretty good idea if it's shedding at a level that suggests clinical illness. Does that make sense? So that's a cool new tool that we have available to us. I think the important thing is, you know, it's common that shelters will sort of flail and try this antibiotic and try that antibiotic and have an outbreak of unusually severe upper respiratory infection for weeks or for months, rather than making a one-time investment in diagnostics. And it's hard to spend the money on diagnostic testing. But IDEX offers a good price for shelters and really just 10 samples one time, figure out what's going on, and then you can intervene in a way that's effective and ultimately really saves a lot of money. So I used to leave treatment for the very end and then I would never get to it because I get so excited about prevention. But I recognize that treatment is an important part of the picture, especially as we're all learning how to completely prevent upper respiratory infection. And as I said, when I first worked in a shelter, we didn't treat URI. And part of our rationale was we couldn't find homes for all the healthy cats, so why would we treat sick cats? So that we would just have to make other decisions about euthanasia. And part of our rationale was we didn't really know how to contain upper respiratory infection. But the result of that policy was that we all went deaf when a cat we liked was sneezing. And the result of that is the cat would sit there sneezing, not getting the treatment he or she needed, creating a bad reputation for us, spreading yet more disease, and causing more problems for us in the long run. So lots of reasons why treatment is important, not only on an individual level, but actually as a population health tool. We can't treat viruses in general. Anti-herpes viral medications have to be given so frequently and are so costly that they're not practical for use on a widespread basis in shelters, and locally not necessary to control upper respiratory infection or to treat upper respiratory infection in most cases. So why would we be throwing antibiotics at upper respiratory infection in the first place? And this is from Dane County Humane Society. I believe from the treatment ward that there used to be there.
No, it's from quarantine.
Oh, that's from quarantine. When a cat gets a herpes virus infection or a calicivirus virus infection, I've seen histopath, and it just wipes out the top layer of cells. And it leaves it raw and vulnerable to whatever bacteria might happen to float by and settle on that poor ulcerated surface. And if you've ever gone into stray holding at a typical animal shelter, you know, there's litter dust and there's poo particles and there's just a funk in the air and there's bacteria floating through that funk. And so a cat in a shelter environment that experiences a viral respiratory infection is much more at risk for developing a secondary bacterial upper respiratory infection, and that can create more severe and longer disease. And so there is a rationale in some situations for antibiotic treatment, but keep in mind too that ideally, both from a public health and a population health and a humane perspective, we would change the housing environment so that the air quality is better, so that there's not so much bacteria floating by. But given that there is, what we find is that when we test, it's a mix of gram-negative and gram-positive bacteria. And then we also have mycoplasma, which in itself, if you just put a cat and a mycoplasma together in a room, you don't get very exciting disease. But mycoplasma is cunning, and it's a respiratory immunosuppressant. And so if it's present, and there's herpes virus or calicivirus or another one around, it's gonna make the other pathogen more serious, and it's gonna make the disease worse. So there is a rationale for treating mycoplasma in cats that are ill, even if they might be ill with a mix of two different things. And the thing about mycoplasma is that it doesn't have a cell wall. So those of you who have had pharmacology, what does that mean in terms of what classes of antibiotics, if any, does that rule out?
Penicillins.
Yep, another one?
Cephalosporins.
Yes, so penicillins and cephalosporins target the cell wall, and so de facto they will not treat mycoplasma. Chlamydophila and Bordetella are sporadically important, and that's important to know because they're intracellular bacteria, and only some antibiotics do a good job of penetrating into the intracellular space. So those are some things to keep in mind when you're reaching for a jar of antibiotics in a shelter environment to treat upper respiratory infection. So the rule about antibiotics is always and never if you can get away with it. So ideally, we want to look at an individual patient and say, is there evidence of a bacterial infection? And if there isn't evidence of a bacterial infection, we don't want to treat. And some studies have come out on people with flu who receive antibiotics, it actually causes some immunosuppression. And that's the last thing that we want to do. You know, antibiotics are powerful chemicals. They all have side effects. We don't want to use them if they're not needed. And so if the environment is such that the cats tend to recover in just a few days without antibiotic treatment, then hold off. Don't use the antibiotics. On the other hand, in some shelters, just the air quality is crummy and the isolation place is dank and there's a lot of bacteria floating around and you try and hold off and after 3 days you find always snot is pouring out the cat's nose and you end up reaching for the antibiotics. And in those situations we found that just starting the antibiotics as soon as you put the cat in that hellhole will cut a few days off of the time of treatment, and that will help you move more cats through treatment and mean it's less crowded in the treatment area, so it can be beneficial. So long-term plan, fix what's making it so that all the cats get bacterial secondary infections in your treatment area. But short-term plan, go ahead and start antibiotics if you always end up putting them on antibiotics. And think about having a 1-2 plan of here's the first drug we reach for and here's the second drug we reach for, because we're not going to do diagnostics on every single cat. And be pretty quick about saying, you know what, it's been 5 days and cat is not responding to drug one, so our guess was wrong on drug one, and we're gonna reach for drug two that has a different spectrum of effect, different strengths than drug one. You can actually mix drugs if you know that you're dealing with something that has a cell wall and you also want something that's gonna be effective against mycoplasma, and you don't have a perfect drug that's gonna have the spectrum that you need. You can have two drugs at once, but most of the time, you only need one, and you want one that you know is going to get mycoplasma and chlamydia and Bordetella, and you want one that you know is going to be effective against gram-negative bacteria. That's usually not the same one. And you want to treat to either they're better or they're not better, and there's no evidence that continuing to treat them for longer is going to get them better. So if they're not responding to antibiotic treatment in 5 to 7 days, then generally, that's not going to be successful to continue it for another 5 to 7 days. It's just going to keep them in treatment longer. And if they've responded, remember, those bacteria are just hanging out in the air, in the nose, all the time. And so we're not trying to create a sterile environment, with the exception of chlamydia, which I'm going to talk about separately. When you're treating run-of-the-mill upper respiratory infection, you know you're not trying to sterilize their nasal cavity. And so you just treat until signs have cleared up. And if it's a shelter where monitoring is poor and people don't spend a lot of time in the treatment area and maybe they're not really quite cleared up on the first day that we think they're cleared up, maybe you want to go another day or two or three. But be pretty aggressive and try stopping treatment on the first day that the cat is no longer sneezing or no longer showing the signs that made you think it needed antibiotics. Then if they always bounce back in a couple days and start pouring snot again, then extend the time of treatment out a little bit. But don't treat randomly to 7 or 10 or 14 days. That's something that you do when you're trying to create a sterile environment, like in a bladder infection, or you're trying to completely eliminate an infection that is not normally present. Does that make sense? So that's a little bit of a different way of thinking about it. Part of it is that in a shelter environment, we're always in sort of a rush. We don't want the animals to linger there, and we especially don't want them to linger in isolation areas where often the conditions are not awesome. And also, it's precious space that's needed to move other cats through it. If cats are there for a long time under treatment, that's fewer cats that can be served with that area. When we're working with kittens, they're getting less cute day by day. So we really just want to move them out of there as fast as we possibly can. Same as with disinfectants that I talked about at lunchtime, You gotta deal with the realities of the shelter environment, and so if your perfect fantasy drug has to be given 3 times a day, and there's only staff to do it once a day, then you just gotta compromise and find a drug that can be given once a day, a dosing schedule that works with the shelter staffing levels, and use that drug even if it's not your most ideal choice from a spectrum of effect perspective. And again, think about cost. The most costly drug is one that's not working, and it's a big waste of time, and it's just stressing the cats and stressing the staff. So that's something to, you know, bring up with the shelter management if they're giving you a hard time about a drug. One that works more quickly and more effectively can be less costly, even if each pill costs a little bit more. And then, do no harm. We investigated an outbreak once where a strep canis, a necrotizing strep canis infection, bacterial infection, was riding around on the shared syringe that was used to give doxy to all the cats. And, you know, the cats already had this sort of abraded, raw upper respiratory cavity, and then it was injected into their oral cavity with the syringe, and then it created necrotizing abscesses, in some cases, that went into the cat's brains. So, one cat, one set of drugs, just like a patient. Doxycycline, you probably know this. It can cause esophageal ulceration, so you either want to mix it into a liquid or give it as a tablet and then flush afterwards with a liquid. It's okay. There's a lot of studies that have been done on what can you mix doxycycline with. And like, you can mix it with pudding, it turns out. You can mix it with orange juice, but cats don't like that. But milk products are okay. Chicken soup is okay. Citric acid is contained in some commercial compounding formulas that you can get, like to compound your own drugs. That can cause toxic byproducts when the compounded formula expires. So you don't want to use citric acid if you're doing your own compounding. And the important thing to know about doxycycline and tetracyclines in general is that they're unstable in solution. So you need to remix. If you're making your own liquid formula, you need to remix it every week. So you don't have to do it every day, but like every week on Sunday, you gotta remix it. It actually can last as long as 2 weeks, so if you're sending home a prescription with somebody, you can give it out to 2 weeks. But I think it's just hard to remember to reformulate every 2 weeks, so in a shelter environment, you just wanna do it weekly. And some commercial formularies, pharmacies, offer products that are labeled for a longer shelf life, but they are not able to explain why it would have a longer shelf life than it has in the lab. And so I would view that with some suspicion until they can offer a coherent explanation for that. Yeah. The question is, what about putting doxy into gel caps? It's fine to put it into gel caps if that gives you the dose you want, but you still have to follow with a liquid flush. The capsules are just as likely as the tablets cause the esophageal ulceration. So remember chlamydia, or chlamydophila, which is its official name, is rare. You don't usually have it. But the thing about chlamydophila when you do have it is that it can be very persistent. And we don't expect to have it, so it's reasonable to think that you should clear from the cat completely. So we think about chlamydophila as most classically being associated with ocular signs, with conjunctivitis. So if you have suspicious clinical signs, or you've diagnosed it, if you get a positive result on PCR for chlamydophila, that's significant because it's rare in healthy cats. And especially if it responds to doxycycline, Clavamox, fluoroquinolones, Zithromax, or topical tetracycline, those are all drugs that can initially treat chlamydophila. However, with all but doxycycline, it will recur in a percentage of cats. So if you treat and they respond within 7 days, and then within 14 to 30 days, within 2 weeks to a month, the signs come snapping back, and you treat again with doxycycline and the signs go away again, be very suspicious of chlamydophila if you haven't already diagnosed it. And then you want to continue treatment for 4 weeks at least. And doxycycline is the only one that's been published as working in that situation. You can use a once a day
treatment schedule, so it's not too horrible. And as soon as clinical signs have completely resolved, they're not contagious to other cats. This has been looked at, and so they can go ahead, go out for adoption, go to home, go out to foster care, whatever you want to do during that 4 weeks. They don't have to linger in some treatment room, but you do have to continue the treatment. Yeah.
Has the raising price of doxycycline lately been a hardship for shelters?
So the question is, has the increased price of doxycycline been a hardship for shelters? I was hoping nobody would ask that. Yes, it has been. And the difficulty with getting doxycycline. Minocycline is another drug that has a very similar spectrum of effect. Dr. Newberry was supposed to be madly trying to find out if it has the same concerns about esophageal ulceration. It is also a little more expensive than doxycycline used to be, but it is it's another treatment choice. But it's also a good, you know, even at a increased price, if you're using it only when you really need it, and if you're doing what you can to prevent upper respiratory infection and create good treatment conditions, then you can afford to treat the few cats who will still really require treatment. This is just an example of a consistent plan. So if you're working with a shelter or a rescue group population, it's good to just have a plan like these signs equal this treatment. And one of the reasons why that's important is, especially if different veterinarians are working with the shelter, you want to be able to pick up a difference in the response to treatment. So if you always treat the cats first time with doxycycline, second time with Baytro, and then all of a sudden, instead of getting better after 5 days, they're not getting better until 8 days or 10 days, it's a lot easier to pick up that it might be a change in pathogen or a change in the conditions in the treatment area versus a change in the efficacy of your antibiotic versus if you're using five different antibiotics depending on the day of the week and the veterinarian who's there. So we have a sample treatment plan that people can download on our website. It's not that those are the exact drugs that you should use, but that you should create a treatment plan that makes sense for the drugs that can be used in that particular environment that seem to work well in your hands for that population of cats. Supportive care is an important component. Delicious, stinky food, fluids as needed, pain control, and important, you know, remember, URI in cats, not like a cold in you, it hurts. So, you know, make sure that cats are adequately hydrated, but also do provide pain control. Humidification and nebulization, don't overdo it so that they're always in a moist environment, but, you know, humidification or nebulization for some time. In general, nebulizing drugs is not necessary if other things are well managed in the treatment area. Yeah.
I don't know if you'll get to this, but what do you recommend for pain control?
Who would like to weigh in on what would you recommend for pain control? Dr. Newberg?
Buprenorphine is the one I've used the most recently. And it really is important. I mean, I've seen cats, especially cats with Khaleesi virus, who are just like, you see them and they're just a wreck. And you treat them with fluids and pain meds, and like pain meds just makes all the difference. And people really often forget about it with URI. They just don't think about it.
But I think it's important to recognize, and so that for if you couldn't hear this on the webcast, buprenorphine is one choice that's common and can be really helpful. But some shelters don't have the ability to have control drugs, and so, you know, be aware of other pain control options when you graduate. There might be new awesome things that are labeled for cats on the market. Be aware if a cat has a really painful mouth that you might want to use an injectable product if you can't find one that's tolerated orally. So again, just as with antibiotics, you need to consider the cat and what's appropriate for that situation, but remember pain control. If you're gonna do nose drops, something that you might have learned in your pharmacology class is that the receptors for those quickly become refractory, and they also become refractory to the body's own decongestants, like natural decongestants. So there can be a bounce back period after nose drops are discontinued if they're not just plain saline. So first try saline nose drops, like baby nose drops, like little noses, and then every other nostril, if you're going to use nose drops that are actually drug-based, I forget what the name of the drug is, something that keeps me awake, phenylephrine or something like that. Fever reducer if necessary, and really important to remember balancing with stress. So this technician was absolutely gleeful, And this was at a shelter that thought that they were having a Bordetella outbreak. And they were very alert, and they monitor each cat for the slightest sign of disease. And a cat would get a little piece of litter stuck in her nose, and she'd give a sneeze, and they would whip the cat out of the cage and give her B vitamin and lysine and fluids. And then it turned out they were having herpes, because the stress of the supportive care was making the cats crazy. So don't overdo it. And this was a fascinating article that I read in Oprah. And I want you to know I'm only allowed to read Oprah after my battery has died on airplane flights. But then that's my guilty pleasure. And this is an article about the characteristics of the perfect hospital room. And it's not that we're going to make the perfect hospital room, but it's just to be aware of the impact of the conditions in which treatment takes place. And that is actually more important in many cases than what drug you pick to treat. And this has real effects that residents in private rooms were 3 times less likely to catch the flu and got 1.3 more hours of sleep. And so what does that mean for a cat in an isolation area? Maybe that means it's quiet in there, that they don't have another cat looking at them every minute of the day, that they don't hear the sound of barking dogs, that they have the opportunity to really sleep deeply and not have to feel like they're on guard all the time. Carpeting. So visitors who provide valuable social support and physical assistance tend to stay about 8 minutes longer on average when rooms are carpeted. Now, I'm not saying we should carpet our isolation wards, but that we should remember the social needs of animals that are sick, and that we want to create space in treatment areas, especially if cats are going to be in there for a little while being treated, so that they can have some social time, so that kittens that are in a really socially important window for exposure to different things can interact with human beings in some way other than having doxycycline shoved down their throats. So we want to think about that. A view of nature, people who could see nature needed fewer pain meds and stayed an average of 0.74 fewer days at the hospital. So real biologically meaningful consequences of just the things that people were exposed to in a treatment area. Sound absorbing ceiling tiles led to more restful sleep and a lower rate of rehospitalization. Light filled windows meant 22% less pain medication, and death rate was about 61% higher in facilities that lack natural light. Holy cow! And, you know, maybe you can't provide natural light in a treatment area, but maybe you can provide like soft blankets and put a plant in there and put some fish or a television in there for them to watch. You know, just think about like what's it like to be a sick cat and be staring at a blank wall and listening to barking dogs all day. And I don't know if I have a graph of this in this particular presentation, but studies have found that sick cats are even more impacted in terms of stress by the sound of barking dogs than well cats are. And it makes sense, you know. A dog is a predator for a cat, and when they are sick and they're feeling vulnerable, it's just like if you were sick and then somebody, like the nurse, was standing there cursing at you and you couldn't escape, it would be really scary. Right? So really prioritize quiet and the protection from the sound of barking dogs in treatment areas. Good air quality is super important. And I remember a time when I went to an animal shelter, it was really crowded and the treatment ward was full and they had a big outbreak of URI, so they took a bunch of cats and tossed them into a horse stall in their barn. And I was like, well, that's a disaster. Those cats all got better. They had awesome air quality. It was away from barking dogs. They weren't hassled, it was quiet, and they did great. So, you know, sometimes, even though they weren't housed in little individual cages, it was a big space for the number of cats that there were. They each had their own little house or crate or bed that they could hide in, and they really did well. Yeah, Sandra.
So it looks like there's no warnings about minocycline for esophageal stricture, but there's nothing saying that it doesn't cause it either.
Okay.
But they do think it's safer for some of the bone abnormalities, bone and teeth issues. So
this just in, minocycline perhaps preferable in terms of bone and teeth issues. So if you were worried about getting yellow teeth in your show kitten, minocycline might be the better choice. But I would say you know, if there's not published data one way or the other, it may well be an issue of use, you know, frequency of use, rather than that it's really safer. There are other drugs other than doxycycline that can cause esophageal strictures. We just know that doxycycline is a particularly high risk. So I would err on the side of still using the liquid flush or giving it as a liquid.
Yeah, it still is a tetracycline, so.
Really important for cats to have a hiding spot. If there's not room for a hiding spot in a treatment area, to put a half cage cover, whether that's hanging a towel or actually sewing a half cage cover, custom to fit the cage. But when they're sick, they really need to be able to feel like they can be concealed. At the same time, you want to be able to look at them to make sure that they're doing all right. If you're not having an unusual outbreak of disease, if you don't think you got Khaleesi virus going on, or if you think everybody's got the same Khaleesi virus because they were all exposed at the same time and place, then you don't need to obsess about changing gloves and changing clothes in between every cat. And as I said, this is a picture of another thing that horrified me. This chain link pen, and there was a chair in there, and they would just take the cat out of the cage when they were cleaning and go put it in that room, that little chain link pen. And sometimes they would have volunteers go in there and sit and read the cat's stories, and they would wear the same top with every cat. And I was like, this is gonna be another disaster. Worse than the Barnes doll. And it was great, and the cats did great, and they loved getting out of the cages, and the kittens stayed social, and it was fine. So, don't freak out about it. They all got the same thing. Unless there's something else, you know, unusual going on. And when there's something unusual going on, lock it down. Change gloves between cats. Don't use your little chain link pen. When you have a veterinary clinic and the cats are coming from a shelter and a cattery and a pet home, then one cat might have chlamydia, one cat has Bordetella, one has herpes, one has Khaleesi, and they shouldn't mix like that. So you can't be relaxed like that in a veterinary clinic isolation area.
One thing Dr. Hurley and I were just talking about this afternoon in terms of the people that we train, that one of our goals for the people that we train is that you guys will be able to go out into the world and understand what the rules are, but not think that those rules are something that has to be applied in the exact same way every place you go, that you'll be able to sort of look at a situation and evaluate and sort of figure out in this situation how important is that by really understanding the foundation of the rule.
And foot baths are something I didn't get to cover in my disinfectant talk, but I'll cover them now. In studies of foot baths, when people dipped their foot, like used a foot bath correctly, which they're rarely used correctly even, with adequate contact time and scrubbing and full coverage of the full sole of the shoe, it did actually decrease bacteria on the bottom of the shoe when an effective disinfectant was used, which was potassium peroxymonyl sulfate, but not bleach and not quaternary ammonium foot baths. Those didn't even reduce bacterial contamination on the bottom of the shoe. But even the ones that did reduce contamination on the shoe didn't reduce bacterial contamination before versus after the foot bath. So if it wasn't killing off bacteria, it's not killing off Khaleesi virus, which is tougher. And it is moistening everybody's shoes, which makes them more effective at tracking disease extensively. So in general, you don't need to worry about footwear. You know, cats aren't mostly on the ground unless you have some horrible situation where cats are all in group rooms and then there's some group upper respiratory room and you're tracking from the upper respiratory room into the kitchen room. But in general, when you have sort of more traditional housing or not tons of sick cats everywhere and kittens running around on the ground, you don't need to worry about footwear. If you do have something serious going on, then you need to use dedicated shoes or shoe covers for any treatment area. And that goes for a treatment for kennel cough in dogs too. Just routine respiratory disease in the dogs, don't worry about it. If it's parvo, forget about the foot bath, it's not good enough. You need to just use dedicated shoes. And that's why I say don't use them most of the time, because then I want, the bargain is, you must use them when there's really something serious going on. Fair enough? So the question often arises, especially when the URI treatment area is a dismal dungeon. Like, really, do I have to put the cat in there? Then it's really gonna get sick. So in-place treatment can be okay if housing allows for spot cleaning of the cat without a whole lot of handling of cats. So if there's double compartment housing, and you can just easily tuck the cat into its little side compartment and then clean the main compartment and then move the cat over and clean the side compartment without getting all involved with the cat and the cat all over your clothes, then you can get away with treating in place. And if staff and volunteers, whoever's responsible for cleaning, can cope with the concept of, like, this cat is marked with an I'm under treatment sign, and so you don't clean that cat first and then go clean all the kittens. You clean all the kittens, then you clean that sick cat last. No out-of-cage fun and games for cats that are under treatment in an area where there's also healthy cats, and especially in an area where there's kittens. And a change of top after care of those cats. And in general, a change of top after care of cats in an isolation area as well, but also to have the understanding that when you go to care for the sick cats, the three sick cats that are on the adoption floor, then you put on this lab coat, and then when you're done taking care of them, you take off that lab coat before you go on with the rest of your day. You want to mark the cage clearly so that, partly so the public knows, hey, I know this cat is sick, we're taking care of it, we're on top of it, we're not just a shelter that puts up sick cats for adoption without thinking about it. I worked with a shelter that had an outbreak of multi-drug resistant salmonella typhimurium that hospitalized a bunch of people and could have killed some just based on the odds of that illness. And one thing they were doing is treating a lot of cats with URI up on the adoption floor with antibiotics that the salmonella was resistant to. And so I sort of draw the line at, if they need antibiotic treatment, then go ahead and move them to a treatment area. What about treatment in foster care? That's another option, especially, you know, again, if the treatment area at the shelter is non-existent or really horrible. What you don't want to do is end up sending a cat to a foster home for treatment and either having that cat not get the monitoring and treatment that it needs, or worst case scenario, infecting the foster parent's other cats and causing something serious. So you want to think about, if it's just run-of-the-mill, probably herpes, it's an endemic URI shelter, then, or if it's a chronic upper respiratory infection case, then it's probably going to be fine around pet cats. And in general, adult cats with upper respiratory infection are lower risk than kittens with upper respiratory infection to pet cats in a home. The sort of tricky thing about kittens is that if they have Khaleesi virus, they often got matching antibodies to that Khaleesi virus from their mother, so it can suppress the severe symptoms of Khaleesi virus, and then they can transmit severe Khaleesi virus to pet cats in a home. It's not something that happens commonly, but just in general, if you have a foster home available and you have an adult cat or a kitten with URI, you might want to think about sending the adult cat to the foster home in terms of minimizing risk to other pet cats in the home. Send the kitten to a foster home that ideally doesn't have other cats or has a good way to isolate the kitten within the home. Pet cats should be revaccinated annually for herpes and Khaleesi. That vaccine does provide protection for 3 years, but the strength of the protection wanes, and so it's not a bad idea, and particularly because there is an intranasal vaccine available for herpes and Khaleesi, so you don't have to worry about increasing the risk of vaccine-associated sarcomas. So that's just a way that you can at least encourage foster parents to revaccinate their pets. Do I do it? No, actually, I don't. I figure my cat is just revaccinated by all the mayhem that I bring into his life. But it's not a bad idea. The other thing that's available is the two-way Khaleesi virus vaccine. It is a killed vaccine, but it provides protection against a broader range of Khaleesi viral infections, so that would be another vaccine to talk to foster parents about for their pets. I might only use that one every 3 years, and then use the intranasal year in the vaccine in the years intervening. And then if there's any whiff of severe Khaleesi virus, then you want to back away from sending those cats into homes. And that's just my snot-nosed foster kitten and then mauling her child in her new home. And then I'm just going to finish up the treatment section by talking a little bit about chronic or non-responsive URI. How many of you have dealt with just a chronic snotty cat? most of you. We love them, right? So you want to differentiate between, is it a population level thing? Are all the cats or many of the cats that go into treatment not responding as they usually are? And then you want to look at, okay, you know, do we have chlamydia going on? Do we have something else going on? Is there a problem with the ventilation system in the treatment room? Is adoption all jammed up and so the cats are just sitting in the treatment room until they get sick again? Or is it an individual cat within a population that are mostly clicking through treatment in the way that you would expect? And then remember that just because an individual cat is a shelter cat doesn't mean that that individual is not suffering from some individual level kind of disease, because shelter cats can have that happen. So for some cats, they don't have a great mucosal immunity. They just can't kick it. For some cats, the shelter environment just blows their minds and they can't get over it. And they're just too stressed. Also, they might have chlamydia. We talked about that. They could have a polyp, which is common in young cats and associated with viral infections. They could have a fungal infection. If they're an older cat, they could have neoplasia, they could have tooth bone, they could have foxtail in their nose, they could have a worm growing in there. Since this is Wisconsin, we have cerebra. The important thing about chronic respiratory infection is call it early. If a cat has not responded after about 5 days to your first treatment and 5 days to your second treatment, say, this one isn't doing well in this situation. Don't let it linger there for 6, 8, 10, 12 weeks. It's not helping the cat, it's not helping the other cats, it's costing money and it's not productive. So make sure that you've used a treatment that's effective against chlamydophila, and doxycycline would be the one of choice, and make sure that you've used a treatment that's effective against gram-negative bacteria, and doxycycline would not be the one of choice. So for instance, a fluoroquinolone or clavamox would be a good choice to try and knock those out. Then do a really careful physical exam. Think about whether it's unilateral, bilateral, that'll help you rule in or rule out some possibilities. If you haven't already tested the cat for retroviral infection, test that, see if the immune system it could be a problem. Do diagnostics, send out a panel on PCR, see if you've got chlamydia there. If you've got the wherewithal to anesthetize the cat and the cat is healthy enough to undergo that, neuter, spay, and do a polyp check. And you can do a nasal flush at the same time, that can be helpful. But bottom line is get them out of there and try for antibiotic treatment. And the biggest mistake that people make is not treating long enough once you find an antibiotic that works. So if they respond within the first week of treatment, then continue treatment for 8 weeks. So Zithromax is a nice choice if it works, because you don't have to give it every single day. Doxycycline, sometimes you can get away with giving that only once a day. But try different drugs that might be effective, that have good penetration into tissue and into bone in general, and then carry on with treatment. Humidification can help, outdoor access can help, but what can really help is just getting the cat the heck out of the shelter. A lot of them will resolve if they're out of the shelter environment. And a lot of them, or if they don't resolve, then adopt them to the home of a person with poor eyesight or mucus-colored walls. This is a friend of mine who came to visit California, and we inflicted one of these cats on her, and she took it back to Georgia where she couldn't do anything about it. But don't keep them in limbo and isolation. It's just some problem with their own nasal structure. A lot of times herpes virus will just sort of wipe out their nasal turbinates and their immune system can't kick it, and they're always going to be, you know, chronically, it's going to recur. It's not an infectious risk to other cats. You can go ahead and put them up for adoption. They can go ahead and go into homes. Often they're the best cats. So that is the end of the treatment section. Now we're going to get back to the part that really excites me, which is how to not find yourself standing in a hallway with your treatment room full and a whole bunch of cats and carriers with towels over them waiting to get started. So we can fix this if it happens, but it would be so much better to just stick with this. So here's my slide of what causes feline upper respiratory infection. But you saw that cats come into shelters with those in similar proportions, but they express at much different rates in different shelters. So we can't say that herpes virus actually causes URI, because cats walk into shelters all the time with herpes virus and don't get URI. And the same with all the other pathogens. So what really causes URI? That is a question we asked. Is it a problem with vaccination, disinfection, nutrition, air quality, stress, a place to hide, nowhere to run to? I'm going to go through this part pretty quickly because it's in the slides. But I want you to understand both the strengths and limitations of vaccination for upper respiratory infection. It can mitigate the severity of disease when it works. And it works most of the time to mitigate the severity of herpes infection and some of the time for calicivirus virus. It takes some time for protection to kick in. So it's not awesome in the way that the panleukopenia vaccine is awesome. So for many cats, they'll have to receive a vaccine and a booster and then wait a week before they really receive full protection. So think about that when people are starting up in foster care, make sure that the cats have the full series under their belt and a week for it to kick in for the subcutaneous vaccine. And for shelter cats, ideally we would get this vaccine into them 2 weeks before they come into the shelter. So a good reason to schedule intake for shelter cats to at least allow one vaccine to be on board. And then when they come in, get the next vaccine on board, and hopefully you'll see some protection soon after they've come in the door. But really what we're doing when we're vaccinating is we're providing protection against panleukopenia, which is awesome. And we want to use a subcutaneous modified live vaccine for that, if you haven't already gotten that in this class. And this is true mostly, again, for panleukopenia, but we want to revaccinate kittens every 2 weeks while they're in a high-risk environment, every 3 to 4 weeks when they're in a non-high-risk environment, which would include a clean foster home where there's only one litter in the home. But regardless, and have they had vaccines in this class?
They just had Dr. Schultz.
All right. Final vaccine at 20 weeks, you all understand why. Okay. Happily nodding heads. The intranasal vaccine, theoretically, should be great because it can provide faster protection and it provides local mucosal protection. But in reality, it's received mixed reviews in shelter studies. So in one study, it was added on top of a killed vaccine, and there was a modest benefit. At Dade County, they tried adding it on top of a modified live sub-Q vaccine, and there was no effect. In a study that we did comparing respiratory rates at shelters using it and shelters not, the shelters that were using it actually had a higher rate of upper respiratory infection than the shelters that were not. We don't know if that's causative or if the shelters were just desperate because they had such high upper respiratory infection and so they were using it. And in fact, at the shelter that had the lowest rate of upper respiratory infection, they were also using it. So we know it doesn't cause high rates of upper respiratory infection, but it's just, it's not a magic bullet in the shelter environment. So if you decide to use it, really track what's happening before and after, because it does add to the expense. And we talked about pets in foster homes and high-risk adult cats. Yeah. So the question is, for cats that come in over 20 weeks, are you still going to do that 2 to 3 week booster? Oh, actually, you do want to booster the respiratory vaccines. So the panleukopenia vaccine in general is going to protect after the very first vaccine received at or after 20 weeks. But the respiratory vaccines there aren't as awesome. And so if you don't know that the cat has previously been vaccinated, you do want to booster it 2 to 3 weeks after administration. You know, if a shelter is struggling financially and all they can do is get one vaccine to every cat as they come in the door, again, the big bang for your buck is in that first vaccine protecting against panleukopenia. By the time they've been in the shelter for 2 to 3 weeks in most shelters, they're going to have been exposed to whatever they were going to be exposed to. They were going to get upper respiratory infection. But at a shelter that has longer stays and not a high rate of upper respiratory infection, Calicivirus virus is a much more sporadic threat, and so it would be really appropriate and helpful in a shelter that's got long stays and the cats might stay 2 to 3 months, and every once in a while calicivirus sweeps through, then you'd get some bang for your bucks with revaccination at 2 to 3 weeks after entry. And for pet cats, for sure, revaccination, whenever you find the cat, comes into your hand, you get it, you vaccinate it once, 2 or 3 weeks later, revaccinate. Yeah. So, great question. Is the Khaleesi vaccine the one that tends to have reactions if the cat's going to react? No, it's the chlamydia. So, in general, bacterial vaccines are a little bit more reactogenic. And so that's why we tend to focus on the, you know, the viral components, unless we think the bacterial is a real threat. There is a chlamydia vaccine, but you want to reserve that for use in shelters where chlamydia has been diagnosed. And then you maybe want to use it for a few months, break that cycle, and then back off. And same with the Bordetella. There's a feline Bordetella vaccine, but since it's not usually a problem in shelters, you don't want to use it in general. But if you have it, yes, break it out, give it for a few months, and then try discontinue it and see if you can, if you've broken the cycle of infection. And I'm not going to talk about this because we're short on time, but I'm just going to say for the web audience and for those of you who missed this afternoon talk, that spot cleaning is one of the most important things. That's the most important disinfectant activity you can engage in to reduce URI in cats, is to clean less and clean less stressfully and disrupt the cat's environment less. And I will upload these notes to the course section of sheltermedicine.com, and you can click right here where it says spot clean, and it'll take you right to our spot cleaning section of the website for the details. I do want to talk about nutrition, because we looked at just body weight and food intake in cats in the first week of stay in a kind of typical shelter, and we were shocked that a high percentage of the cats lost a lot of body weight and a high percentage of the cats got up a respiratory infection. And here, can you see, what is that? What is that in the cat's dinner bowl? It's a turd. And you know, how did that happen? And the cat was sitting right here looking so disgusted and embarrassed by this situation. Like, no wonder they're losing weight. There's poop in the food bowl. Or there's litter in the water dish and they're not drinking and they're not hydrated. And so a herpes virus comes along and floats down onto their poor dehydrated mucosa in their nutritionally depleted state, and they're just sitting ducks. There's nothing they can do. So really think about the importance of nutritionally supporting cats, especially in that critical first week or two in the shelter environment. You want to have a highly absorbable, high-quality diet. If the shelter can't afford it all the time, again, it's most important in that first 7 days when they're just still adjusting to so much. And they're not going to eat normally, maybe, and so it's really important that they can absorb as much nutrients as possible from what they do eat. Now, have some variety on hand for picky eaters. Separate food and litter by at least 3 feet if you can. Elevate food dishes onto holders if you can, to just get them out of the line of fire from the litter pan. Or, you know, there's inserts. This isn't awesome because it doesn't give the cat much room to posture normally, but at least, you know, putting the food and water behind a little barrier can help keep it clean. Or you could put it up here, probably better choice yet. And I mentioned this earlier, but it's important to think about avoiding pairing feeding time with aversive activities that might startle the cat. And think about just dim the lights during feeding time. Make that a time that's sort of like quiet, that's like the fine dining experience. And yes, you're gonna leave the food in the cage, but at least when the food is first offered to the cat, it's fresh and the lights are low and soft music is playing, and the cat's like, yes, I will eat. And check, monitor, because failing to eat is an early warning sign that the cat is in trouble mentally and physically, and it's a time to intervene. I worked with a shelter that just, like, if a cat didn't eat for 2 days, they sent it to foster care. And they've dropped their respiratory infection rate below 1%. So a lot of those cats don't get URI. Maybe they wouldn't get URI, but it's just an early warning sign that this cat is not taking well to the shelter. Probably a lot of you have heard the bad news about lysine. It showed a lot of promise. It is anti-herpes viral in a test tube. But in 2 studies in shelters, not only did it not decrease the risk of upper respiratory infection in cats that were pre-treated with lysine, and in one of those studies, they actually baked it into the food, so there was no stressful administration of lysine at all. But the cats who had been treated with lysine got more upper respiratory, they got more severe signs if they did get sick. And in the first study that showed that, that was considered an anomaly. But since it's been shown twice, we can't figure it out and it doesn't help, don't use it as a preventive. It still hasn't been really proven or disproven as a treatment. So if a cat has chronic, like recurrent weepy eyes every time the owner goes out of town, and you want to try putting it on lysine for that condition, then that's, you know, potentially beneficial. But as a general preventive measure, no, not in a shelter environment, it doesn't help. Talked a little bit about air quality. And in my disinfection lecture, I talked about accelerated hydrogen peroxide and trifectant, these disinfectants that have good penetration into organic matter, that have good penetration into porous surfaces, and mean that we have the freedom to use materials and methods of housing cats that we wouldn't have dared to use when we were relying on bleach. So this is a shelter that we helped design that's got these indoor-outdoor pens for cats, and yes, this is wood. But because they were willing to use wood and coated wire, they were able to cheaply construct a shelter that had great, spacious outdoor areas for cats. And if they have a problem with panleukopenia, they can break out the accelerated hydrogen peroxide and kill that right off. No worries about it at all. And so it's really a healthy environment for cats. Feline upper respiratory infection, not an airborne disease. Did you guys know that? Cats, cute little lungs, just aren't powerful enough to generate a true aerosol. So it can be spread by droplets for up to 5 feet, but it's not going to float out that wire and float down a hallway and float into another cage and cause illness in another cat. So we can relax about that. We can open windows, we can open doors, we can put fans out, and we want to make the air clean and as free of contaminants as we possibly can. And I think you're going to hear about hiding places in your next lecture, so I'm not going to talk about them. I'm going to leave this slide in here. I think that's fair enough, Dr. Newberry. Those of you who are out there in webinar land, you can click on the link and learn all about it.
They will hear so much about it, I'm guessing, from Dr. Carson.
That's what I thought. And I talked about this too, that the contamination on the hands of people who have just walked into the shelter and haven't been cleaning and haven't been treating all morning long are much more sanitary, and you can like afford to let people interact with healthy cats in a shelter on a normal day. It's not a disaster. Do train volunteers to take a look, take in the whole gestalt of the cat and its environment, and check out whether there's diarrhea, whether there's snot on the side of the cage, and check in before interacting with a cat that has any signs of illness. Make sure that the cat has some control about the socialization experience. We don't want it to be socialized into upper respiratory infection by overly vigorous interaction. And you can use aprons between populations, but you don't just necessarily have to worry about clothing contamination between healthy cats that are up for adoption. And one shelter changed the name of the volunteers from kitty cuddlers to kitty butlers, trying to emphasize the fact that really the cat is the center of this process, not the volunteer who wants to impose their desire to cuddle upon the cats. So here's an example of just a way of creating some out-of-cage space in a shelter that wasn't really built for it. Sometimes you can use a get-acquainted room during off hours when the shelter's not open for adoption as a place for the cats to have some out-of-cage time. I think one thing I would do with this is maybe create some visual barriers around some elements of that so the cats aren't completely exposed on all sides. So think about that. If the cat's got a little bed or a hiding box or something in its cage, take that with the cat to the room so that the cat can come out and explore at its own time. But what if you tried all that already and it's still not working? You're vaccinating, you're housing right, you got hiding places. This was a post that I ran into on Vin. Work at a nonprofit open admission shelter in the past several months have brought us rampant URI cats. Our live release rates have been less than ideal. 2010 was 54%. You know, not terrible as the shelters nationally go, but not optimal. One out of two cats leaving the shelter alive. We have an amazing new building that opened in 2009. We have 126 cages, plenty of room. And then we've got a couple of kitty cities and some cat condos that are basically tiny little rooms. We adjusted the temperature, we added hiding boxes, coranda beds. We didn't see any changes in the URI rates. Cats were being euthanized daily because URI was so widespread. The severity of the illnesses were much greater than you see in private practice URI. Cats would go to foster for URI and be there for months with sneezing or conjunctivitis. This is just a post I ran across actually when I was trying to figure out, like, what are people treating with these days? And this was this despairing post. So, why? Why is that? There's gotta be a better way, right? So this was a study, we got a grant from the Morris Animal Foundation, and we tracked upper respiratory infection in 9 shelters across North America for a whole year. We got data on over 250,000 days of cat care, 25,000 cats. And we asked them 49 questions about all their different practices that we thought might impact upper respiratory infection rate. So this was a big version of that study that I showed you at the very beginning that we did the pilot project of. And what was it? What was the key? Anyone want to venture a guess? Well, we put all that data into a giant computer and had an epidemiologist looking at it, and we leaned forward, there was a grinding sound from the computer, and then out popped our statistical significance. And there was 2 things that were statistically significantly associated with lower risk of upper respiratory infection per cat per day. And it was more than 9 square feet of floor space compared to less than 8 square feet of floor space. And all the larger cages were double compartments, so they didn't require moving the cat out on a daily basis to clean. So that was the other thing, was limited movement in the first 7 days of care. And it didn't matter where the cats went from there, whether they went to group rooms or condos or what. It was the square feet of floor space in the first 7 days of shelter care. 50-fold variation in the risk on a per cat per day basis, and 8-fold variation as a percentage of intake. So here is like rock star shelter, no URI, and here is, just to participate in the study, the shelters had to be pretty good because they had to be like with it enough to actually participate in the study. So this is not even the URI rate that you might see at a shelter that's really struggling. And this is the intake at the different shelters in the study, and then the total number of URI cases. So 50,000 total sick cat days. That's just 9 shelters. How much does it cost for a sick cat day? You know, maybe $10. So between 9 shelters, 50,000 sick cat days times $10, $500,000 on upper respiratory infection in 1 year. Man, is that a bummer of a thing to be investing in. Like, there's way better things we could do with $500,000 every year for 9 shelters. And 13% of care days overall, but it ranged from one shelter that was spending less than 1% of their time dealing with sick cats, and they were a shelter that treated every cat to recovery, so it wasn't because they were euthanizing them when they got sick, to about 30% of care time overall spent on care of sick cats. About a third of all the shelter's resources for cat care spent on this one disease alone. So again, this is more of that Venn post, which I swear I did not write, I did not know anything about it. In February, we took a huge step and cut holes between the cat holding cages and inserted PVC portholes, effectively doubling the space available to each cat and cutting the number of cages we had in half. Actually, less than half, because each loft had an odd number. There's a set of triple cages in each loft. Now we've got 60. They went from 126 to 60 cages. The portholes were designed to be permanent openings. We didn't make any doors to close because that is too tempting to revert to less space and more cats. We had many staff and volunteers who were very leery of the change, fearing that more cats would be euthanized because we lacked space. So I want you to vote. What do you think? They went to all that trouble for nothing. It didn't make any difference in the URI rate. The same number of cats were euthanized. Nobody's going to vote for that because why would I bother, right? How about who thinks there is less URI but more cats were euthanized for lack of space? Nobody thinks that? Everybody thinks that shelters could just cut their cage number in half and not have to euthanize more? There was less URI and no change in euthanasia, but they had to send all their extra cats to Kate Hurley's house due to lack of space at the shelter. Who thinks there was less URI and fewer cats were euthanized due to the miracle of the space-time continuum, shorter length of stay for happy, healthy cats? Yay, everybody chooses that. Probably because I would be too sheepish to even bring this up. So we wanted to look, once we did that first study, we went back to Morris Animal Foundation and said, we think we're onto something. Give us another grant and let us replace some of the cages at our local shelter with some larger cages. And let's have a look-see at whether it works to just replace cages with larger ones, or was there something about the shelter with the larger cages that was different in the first place? And so we took out some small sort of typical one compartment stainless steel cage and we put in a two compartment stainless steel cage that was about twice as big. We made it as small as we could to sort of meet, like we measured a bunch of cats and we put them on different angles. And then we made one compartment that was barely big enough to fit the cat and the food and the hiding place and all the different angles of the cat. And then another compartment that was barely big enough for the cat to posture normally in a litter box that seemed like a reasonable size. And this is the stress score. And three is, below three is an unstressed cat, and above three is a stressed cat. And right up about here, we're getting into a frightened or terrified cat. And this red line is the stress score for the first 7 days of cats in the small cages. And it barely went below three by day seven. And the stress score of the cats that in the large cages, it started out a little bit higher on average, but by day two, it was under three. And this was a shelter where one of the main reasons for euthanasia was behavior for cats. And these purple bars is the number of cats euthanized in the large cages, and the blue bars are the number of cats euthanized in the small cages. And being housed in a large cage versus a small cage for, this was intake, this wasn't in the adoption area, was a risk factor for euthanasia. I mean, being housed in a small cage was a risk factor for euthanasia at the shelter. Cats in the large cages were more likely to either be rescued or adopted because they were more likely, probably, to show adoptable behavior, behavior that was perceived as adoptable. And so we were excited about that. What we didn't see was a difference in the risk of upper respiratory infection for the actual cats housed in the large cages. And part of the reason for that might have been that in the beginning, we had less than a quarter of the cages converted to large cages, and the other cats were still in tiny box cages right next door to them. There was prison inmates doing all the cleaning, so they would touch a cat that was stressed and in a small cage and probably shedding herpes and then go touch a cat in a large cage. So there's still a lot of disease spread that went on. But if you look at overall, this column is when there was all small cages in the shelter. This is when these two columns are the same time period over 2 years where we had the mix, some small, some large. And then, since we were like, well, it's easier on the staff, it's nice for the cats, there's lower risk of euthanasia, let's just go for it. And this is when we converted almost all the cages. We put in those portholes and converted them all to large. So percentage of adult cats that developed upper respiratory infection dropped in half when we went from small to all large. And this was the length of stay, or the number of care days. Blue bar is healthy, red bar is sick. So you can see that we decreased the healthy care days pretty significantly and decreased the sick care days into about half of what it was. So that meant our isolation ward was half as full as it used to be. And here's the live release rate over those same time periods. So it went up from 30% to about 50%. From the small cage time period to the large cage time period, even though their intake went up a little bit at the large cage time period. And this was the rest of that post from Vin. We saw some effects right away. The lofts were immediately quieter, cats seeming more relaxed. There were very few cats fake sleeping. The longer term effects are just starting to show up. Cat isolation is empty today because our URI rates have plummeted. Cats aren't breaking with URI right before or after adoption. And now that the statistics for July are in, we found that our live release rate for felines in July 2011 was 70%, up from 50%. In 2010, it was 54%. We euthanized 140 fewer felines in July 2011 compared to July 2010, and those numbers include the cats we euthanize on intake for lack of space. We can convert cages with $15 worth of supplies. It's criminal not to do this. We do need to look at the needed capacity for the shelter and make sure that it is going to be sufficient, but in many cases, when cats are still healthier and they stay a shorter time, we can actually move even more cats successfully through the system. It's still not quite perfect, though, and this was the final sentence in that post. And this brings me back to the question that I asked at the very beginning when I was an animal control officer. Why would we treat for URI when we're euthanizing healthy cats? Because we can't find them homes. We still have to remind ourselves occasionally that we don't have enough homes to save every cat we otherwise could right now. Making the euthanasia decision earlier on is saving a lot of staff time and stress, and in the long run, we've got healthier cats to adopt. Healthier cats will make a difference in the reputation we have and pave the road to even higher numbers. And one of the problems we sometimes see is when shelters make a decision not to euthanize healthy adoptable cats and not to limit intake of cats coming in the door healthy, and that doesn't match the number going out the door adopted, crowding just occurs. And when crowding occurs, we can't provide sufficient space and care to prevent stress. And then we see upper respiratory happen and almost become, it's not a conscious thing usually, but it becomes an excuse for euthanasia. We can say, well, that cat's sick. We're not euthanizing any healthy adoptable animals. Yay for us. We're making them get sick first. And that's not really what anybody wants to do. And so this is the thing where I feel like now we need to take it to a community level and understand that upper respiratory infection is ultimately an expression of an imbalance between the number of cats coming in a shelter and the number of cats for which the shelter can provide quality care and a live outcome. And when that's out of balance, we see crowding, we see stress for everybody concerned, we see URI, and we see euthanasia. Whether the euthanasia comes before the URI or the URI comes before the euthanasia, sort of a moot point for the cat. And you've heard Julie Levy's lecture on community cats, right? Did she talk about San Jose? So they implemented a program to, when a cat comes in that behaviorally is not going to be a good adoption candidate at their shelter, they spay it, neuter it, vaccinate it, ear tip it, microchip it, and put it back where they found it. And they expected that to dramatically decrease their euthanasia rate, and it did. They thought it might decrease their intake, and it did. What they didn't expect was that the number of cats euthanized for upper respiratory infection went from 900 a year to 90. And this is a quote from the director. We have to laugh because it almost seems impossible that one program can impact the numbers so significantly. This is one of those areas of operation that we didn't even know would improve until after we started the program and realized what a positive impact it was having on the incidence of URI and our capacity to handle URI. So they've dropped their intake by about 3,000. They've dropped their euthanasia by about 5,000. That's actually lowering their costs. Taking in 3,000 fewer cats is meaningfully less costly. 3,000 fewer cats to vaccinate. Also means the cat populations in our community are more stable. If cats are creating problems, there's evidence that there's fewer of them running around creating those problems. So it's a win for the community, and it's also a win for the cats remaining in the shelter. So just like putting in portholes is affordable and a win-win because more cats get adopted and they stay healthier and it's less costly and it's more fun, this is a win-win on a really big level where we don't have to use upper respiratory infection to create a balance in our communities because we can just increase the number of cats released alive to include all the healthy cats that walk in the door. The ones that behaviorally are adoptable get adopted. The ones that aren't go back where they were found. Yeah?
Do they keep those unadoptable cats for a stray worker?
They do. At the San Jose program, they do keep them. They actually can spay them during their stray hold period, and it's only 72 hours in California, and then they release them to a rescue group that takes them back to where they are. There are other programs that actually just they come in, they get spayed and neutered, and they get put back out. In California, the law is pretty clear that shelters aren't really required to take in stray cats, and if they take them in, the law says they shall not be killed before 72 hours. It never said you couldn't fix it and put it back. And if you think about community-based TNR clinics that are pretty well accepted in a lot of areas, they don't hold the cats for a stray period. It's just sort of assumed, you know what? If you let the cat run around with its reproductive parts, there is a risk that someone will swoop it up and remove them and put it back without part of its ear. And what they figure is, you know, sometimes a cat is kind of, you know, it's not totally feral, but it's fearful. And they know that it's likely not to get adopted or to sit for a long time or to get up a respiratory infection. And they're like, this is probably someone's cat that they lost. And they don't even know where the shelter is. And they're not going to come in because they couldn't even get it together to spay this cat. And so we're going to do them a service of spaying it and giving it a taxi ride back home. And they've gotten a few complaints, but a lot more people just saying, God, if I had known that was going to happen, the cat would have been at your shelter a lot sooner. And, you know, maybe before it had that other set of babies. Yeah. The question is this something that would work at a place with a longer stray hold? Ideally, then you would bypass the shelter entirely and say, you know what, we don't accept feral cats, but what you can do is take them over here and have them neutered, and then you can take them back where you found them. But certainly, you know, neutering the cat and returning it where it was found, even after 5 to 7 days, I don't think that's enough time for like the cat to forget about its habitat. Because we know that if someone reclaims their cat after 5 to 7 days, that's fine, that works. So if the outcome for that cat would likely be euthanasia, would likely be URI, and it's healthy and it's stray and you know where it came from, still after 5 to 7 days, still better than having it sit in the shelter for another 5 to 7 days after that, waiting for an adoption that doesn't happen. And this is coming back to our local shelter where we did the large case study where I showed that we had hit a rate of 50% live release. And we've been going on at that rate for quite a long time. And that's up from under 20% when we first were working with them in 2009. And so here's 50%, 50% bouncing around. And then here is September of this year. And what do you think happened there? We started a community cat neuter and return program. So now fearful cats that aren't good candidates for adoption that are healthy and weren't causing any extraordinary problem and weren't living in a rare bird reserve or in the sandbox of a daycare center are getting neutered and they're going back where they came from. And I think the hardest thing about this is believing that it really is easier, cheaper, more fun, and more humane to do it in a way where we can provide every cat that's in the shelter with the care that it deserves. We can keep every cat healthy. If a few of them get sick, it's gonna be so few that we can give them awesome treatment, plenty of space, plenty of care, and we can do it without having to euthanize healthy cats, and ultimately, we can do it for less than it takes to just have an ongoing influx of cats and illness and stress and crowding and treatment and outbreaks of multi-drug resistant salmonella typhimurium. There is, like to answer my question from 25 years ago, there is a better way. We know what it is. We can do it in every community. We can do it tomorrow if we really believe that it'll work. And I hope by the time you graduate into a different world for cats, where shelters really are a place where every day in the shelter's care, the cat gets safer and safer and then moves quickly into a home. Thank you. So the question is, how do you convince a shelter that's at capacity, that it feels like in July, we're full? And in July, the shelter with 126 cages was full. And guess what? If they had another 126, they'd get full. It would take another 2 weeks, right? So shelters are always full, however many cages they have. We actually have on our website at sheltermedicine.com, if you type capacity into the search box, we have detailed instructions on how to calculate how much capacity you really need. And then you can look at that and say, well, the calculator says we only need 26 cages, and actually we have 53, so we could get away with this. Or it says we need 26 cages, and actually we have 30, so we could portalize a few of them. And one of the things that you can do, and it's also on our website, is try and develop a strategy so that some cats move really quickly through the system, because it's all about lowering the length of stay for some. And then as you get some cats moving quickly, you can portalize the cages for the ones that are going to stay a little bit longer. So for the cats for whom it really matters the most. And sometimes you might think, oh, you know what, kittens are going to be in here, they're going to fly out of here. All right, we're going to put them in a cage that's smaller, and then for this adult cat who might have a longer length of stay, we're going to put it in a larger cage and then portalize gradually. But like my colleague was just at a shelter in Florida this weekend, and they had a huge adoption event and just emptied a room and then portalized the room. And now you can restart with lower stress and less disease and shorter length of stay and keep it going that way. Yeah, another question.
So is the goal within the double cages to have one cat in there, or are you still doing two cats?
Absolutely. So good question. The question is the goal of the double cages still one cat? Yes. You cannot co-house cats in that space. That's actually more stressful. So you need 18 square foot a cat per cat of floor space if you're going to put them together. The goal of the double housing is that each cat has its own bedroom, living room, dining area, and toilet area separate. And the other thing about that is then when you're cleaning, you don't have to remove the cat. So you have much less time spent on cleaning and much more time spent on other kind of care and monitoring for the cats. Yeah?
The 9 square feet, is that only applies to cages as opposed to like a cageless room?
Right, so in a cageless room environment. And we really looked at the cages because most shelter cats start out in cages. And it's often that first experience that decides whether or not they're going to get upper respiratory infection. When we get into up for adoption and longer-term care, we're more worried about quality of life and stress issues than about upper respiratory infection per se. In a group housing environment, we need 18 square feet of space per cat because they use distance to negotiate their social relationships in that environment. You can count outdoor space as long as the cats have routine access to it, so that's nice because that's often cheap and good air quality, and you can have more of that in the summertime when you're also most impacted by cat numbers. You can't count shelves because you don't want cats to have to stay up on shelves forever and not be able to get down to the floor and access litter pans and food and so on. It's described in the shelter standards. You know, it's not like we did a study with 18 and then 16 and then 20 and, you know, same with the cage. We didn't have every gradation of cage, but that's there are studies that show that less than that was a problem. You know, we don't know exactly where the line falls, but that's a safe line to stick with. And, you know, the same, like sometimes you see a cage and it's like, it's only 8.5 square feet of space. Well, use your common sense. Is there enough room for the cat to lay out? Is there enough room for the cat to stretch up? Is there good separation between the food and the litter pan? Is there enough room for a bed and a toy and for the cat to take several steps? Well then, it's fine, even if it happens to be 8.5 instead of 9 square feet. Okay, thank you so much.